Amen. Thank you, brother. If you have your Bibles, would you please open them to Matthew chapter 5? As we're continuing our study through the Sermon on the Mount and through these wonderful Beatitudes. Beatitudes that are not just a concept. You may be seated, by the way. Beatitudes that are not just a concept, not just an idea, but are a very real part of the life of the born-again child of God, of the new citizen of his kingdom. So I want to thank the brothers, Brother Armando, Brother Jaya's in Sunday school teaching the children today for their leading us through these first Beatitudes. But I want to read just verses chapter 5, Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 7 today, just to refresh and remind us where we are, to get our minds set upon the living God. And this is what the Word of God says to us. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. He opened his mouth and began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the gentle or meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied." And for today's study, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. And so in today's study, what I want to look at is just do a brief review. First and foremost, reminding us of the focus of the kingdom reality, not only in this gospel, but particularly, especially in the Sermon on the Mount, and review just quickly those first four Beatitudes, because what we're going to see now in Merciful is there's a transition in these Beatitudes. And so we're going to look at several definitions of mercy, what it means to be merciful, or to have mercifulness within us because of the grace of Christ. And how is that mercy exercised? How do we exercise, do, show, manifest that mercy toward one another? And then the reality of the already reality of mercy in our lives, be as a child of God living in this fallen world, and what that mercy will yet be like, the not yet reality of that mercy. So first, in the kingdom of God focus, I want to remind us that as this gospel, as this Sermon on the Mount, Matthew gives us a very heavy focus on the kingdom of God with a very heavy Jewish influence, but it is for both Jew and Gentile, and particularly the true Jew, those who have been circumcised in the heart. And so in this, we see in this gospel a distinctiveness of this kingdom. It's one that Jesus himself proclaimed. And when he broke into history and he himself substantiated it by his very real humanity, along with the revelation of God, his divinity, the signs, the wonders, the healings, all demonstrating his kingdom authority in this world and in all creation and over every domain that he has established. Also, we see in those, for those who have been regenerated, who have been born again, who have been transferred into this kingdom by the work of the Holy Spirit, we're now inaugurated. And as a corporate child of God, we receive this redemptive blessedness. It's what's declared by the gospel. It is what is wrought by the Spirit of God through the grace of God and acted upon by faith in Jesus Christ. And so then we see this kingdom into a new citizenship is not something of our own choosing out of our natural inclinations, out of our fallen estate. It's not a kingdom that we sought out. It's not one that we deserve. It's not one that we earn. It is only by that divine transfer from the kingdom of the profane, the kingdom of darkness, what we see in reference to the metaphor of Egypt, out of sin and into a new holy status, a newborn member, a new citizen of a most holy covenantal institution by God. And so it is with this new kingdom comes a radical new set of ethics for us in our life, how we live. It turns the world's thinking upside down because they're deeply rooted characteristics of the very King's life living in us. And our new ethic is that which is wrought by the Spirit in that ongoing work of sanctifying us, of transforming us into the likeness of our King. And so we enter these new blessednesses, these beatitudes of what we're studying are giving us a deeper understanding of the new characteristics, the new character traits that we now have received in salvation. This new deeply realized happiness of soul and what are to be a comprehensive reality in our lives, meaning I don't get to pick and choose. Oh, I want to be merciful. I want to be a peacemaker. These are comprehensive. It's not that we can select our favorites, but that all of these are to be manifest in our souls, in our lives, and will be matured by His grace. And this is not only true of the Beatitudes, it's true of the entire Sermon on the Mount. This is what Christ is setting forth for us. So, any questions so far? Comments? Tracking good? Okay. I love this quote by Martin Lloyd-Jones talking about the Sermon on the Mount, this entire Sermon on the Mount. He says, "We claim to believe that the Son of God has come into the world and has sent His own Holy Spirit into us, His own absolute power that will reside in men and make them live a quality of life like His own. He came, I say, and lived and died and rose again and sent the Holy Spirit in order that you and I might live the Sermon on the Mount, that we would be that salt and light that we're going to look at in the coming weeks, Lord willing. But also the kingdom of God was a very present reality when Christ was here, and it's a very present reality for us now, but it is also still future, as seen in each of the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That's a reality that we partake in now. We are part of that kingdom. We have yet to see the full consummation, the full glory of that kingdom, but we will. That's His promise for those who are in Christ. Amen? All right, so those first four Beatitudes, we see a very necessary, a very logical progression of our spiritual awakening and our transformation. We discover our poverty of spirit. We realize, I am nothing, I have nothing apart from Christ. We not only comprehend our own inability, but we're confronted by the fact that we must and will face God Himself. Not just in the Ten Commandments, not just in the moral law, but in the Sermon on the Mount and in Christ Himself, we're truly helpless, spiritually dead, in sin and in bondage to our fallen nature. But it is by the Spirit we see the blackness of our heart of sin because of the bondage of our sinful nature within us. And seeing our sin, even in the best of our actions, even when we strive to do what is good, by faith and doing those works of righteousness, we're still fully aware that there's sin present. That's why Paul says, having nothing and yet possessing all things, we willingly resign ourselves to the will of God and His goodness. But this is where we see our pride begins to be crushed. The hardness begins to be crushed and melted. Where boasting ceases more and more. There's no more self-glory to the point that we're not concerned about ourselves. No longer on the defensive about what others think and say. And I got ahead. That's actually getting into meekness there and gentleness. Where we renounce our self-dependence. We're schooled by the discipline and our resignation, our submission to the will of God. That's what being meek is about. And so now our interests, our deep longings are an ever-increasing cycle of hungering and thirsting for Him who truly satisfies, but it stirs within us an even deeper, even ever-growing hunger and thirsting for Him. Even though, as Jai pointed out very clearly, very well, we are positionally righteous, we are positionally justified. But it's not that we hunger and thirst for the blessedness or the happiness in and of itself, but Him. It's Christ. And so in this hunger and thirst, there's also a found desire to be free from sin, to see it mortified in our flesh. The whole gospel is what will fill us in our longing to be like Christ. Amen? Okay, that's quick for our review. But now we see a transition in this fifth beatitude. The first four, there's several commentators see this. They identify it more in what you could call a negative sense, not bad, but it's discovering our corruption. It's discovering a consciousness and awareness of our deepest need, our deepest spiritual need. And so we see there's, as I said, the Lord intended a very logical progression through these Beatitudes. And this next Beatitude comes out of all four previous. And there's this very sharp connection of what we're going to see. As I said, you see a negative sense, a progression of our discovery of our need, of our corruption, our consciousness of our great need, and of in Him of whom it is only filled. But now we see in the next three characteristics of the Christian life what our disposition is to be like in this Christian life, the blessednesses that are as fruit of the work of the Spirit. Do you see the connection there from Galatians 5? Of mercy, of purity of heart, of peacemaking. And we can see a relationship here in these beatitudinal characteristics of the believer. Those who have become merciful become conscious of the fact that their mercy is still mingled with sin. And thus, all the more strive after a purity of heart. All the peacemaking is mentioned next in corresponding, I think, of what James talks about, where he says, wisdom that is from above is first what? Pure, and then peaceable. So there's, again, this definite, logical, intentional flow, more so than chronological. And so we begin with the next three with such a searching statement by our Lord. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. But what does it mean to be merciful? Anybody want to take a quick stab at that? What does it mean to show mercy? How are we merciful to one another? Oh, come on. Yes, sister. It is. It is. Anybody else? She said, is it connected to being gracious? I said, yes, it is. Absolutely. That's part of it. Not reviling when reviled, right? Yes, and it is having an attitude, we're going to get into that, and a readiness to forgive. But in the transaction of forgiveness, there should always be a confession and repentance, right? But there's already in us an attitude to forgive. Yes, brother. Yeah. All right. Yes, sister. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes, brother, pastor. Amen.
And so that funneling our, the extension of mercy through and how we have experienced mercy from God will affect happen with what gentleness we treat others, knowing that I'm no different from you, but that God has had mercy on me.
Right.
And so we are able to have mercy on others because we're made of the same fallen flesh, and we're inclined to the same sin.
Amen.
So it helps to be able, unless you are humble and acknowledge that fact, it will be impossible to extend mercy or to be gentle with others.
Amen. Stated well by a good presuppositionalist. Amen. That's right. But what does it not mean? Let's start there. Oh, did you have some?
Oh, I was just going to say
that
mercy stands in contrast to justice. If justice is getting what we deserve, then mercy is not getting what we deserve.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Y'all are on it today. Amen. Appreciate that. That's good. But what does it not mean? Well, it doesn't mean easygoing. That's what the world thinks mercy is about. Easygoing, things don't matter, live and let live. That's being merciful. But it's not addressing the real need. It's not just an easygoing character, and it's not something, as Pastor Landon said, this is not something of our natural state. It's not something in our fallen nature. Yeah, we can be considerate. We can be mindful. But is that really mercy? So I want to get into that deeper. So it's not a temperament that's attributed to anything in our fallen nature. It's not an amiability in the flesh. It has no spiritual value. And it's not regulated by Scripture or exercised under the divine authority of the one who has shown us mercy. So let's get into it. What does it mean? Mercy, being merciful. What does it truly mean to be merciful? And the best way to approach this is in the light of grace, like Sister Brittany said. Mercy is understood as compassionate, to show pity for those in misery with a forgiving spirit toward the sinner. It is sympathy in action. There is an unwillingness to punish in return for injury, not being reviled when you are reviled. And if you look at Paul's pastoral epistles, when he gives instructions to Timothy and to other elders, to other men who are called to the office, you notice that he starts by saying grace, mercy, and peace. So there's really a valid connection there between grace and mercy, but also a distinction implied between the two. One author states the definition of the two as this: grace is especially associated with men in their sins. Mercy is especially associated with men in their misery. Mercy really means a sense of pity with a desire to relieve the suffering. A.T. Peterson, I don't know if you know, familiar with him, he's the pastor who filled in for Charles Spurgeon, which I can't even fathom the shoes to fill there. But he also preached in the pulpit after he died. He had this quote. He said, it is the forgiving spirit. It is the non-retaliating spirit. It is the spirit that gives up all attempt at self-vindication and would not return an injury for an injury, but rather good in place of evil and love in the place of hatred. Another way you could think of mercy too is by the inner working of the Holy Spirit. It is the gracious disposition of the soul toward my fellow creatures and Christians, in inward regard and compassion toward the sufferings of others, with a desire to come to their aid. There's action with mercy. It's not just pitiful thoughts toward other people. And so the mercies of God that we have received as believers instill in us both a proper fear of God and pity on fellow believers and fellow men. That's the source of where our being able to be merciful comes from. Because the more we deeply consider God's sovereign mercy to us, the more we think of the unquenchable fire and the wrath which we have been delivered from, and we are more conscious of our indebtedness to divine grace. There's the grace association. This is what fuels our mercy. This is what extends it outward to others who are in need, and even to those who have wronged us, who hate us, who persecute us. But let's look at the Word of God. I want to pull some examples here too. I don't want to just quote other men. Of course, the greatest example we have is from the Lord God Himself. Here, showing Him the Lord God as the compassionate, the merciful one. You see here His pity. You see His compassionate mercy, which that word for compassionate is also the same word used for being merciful. The Lord God, compassionate, merciful, and gracious, slow to anger. Sounds like James, doesn't it? And abounding in loving kindness and truth. There is the action that is associated with the pity and the mercy. He didn't look upon us as pitiful creatures in need of salvation and go, sorry. Loving kindness, His compassion, His mercy was extended in and through the incarnation of the Son, manifested so clearly, so dearly, so perfectly upon the cross of Christ. Psalm 37, a psalm for those who trust and fear and rest in the Lord. David says here, contrasting the wicked and the righteous, the wicked borrows and does not pay back, but with the righteous there is a graciousness, or with the merciful there is a graciousness, a pity and a favor shown toward those in need because of, you look at the context of the psalm, because of how good and gracious the Lord has been to them. And consider Genesis 50, after Jacob had died and they buried him, Joseph's brothers were fearful. Joseph, who had all right, all the authority to punish them for what they did to him. Yet, what did he do? He says, "For am I in God's place? Am I the one that can exercise retribution?" Fearing God, seeing God's mercy upon himself and his favor, he showed pity. And what did he do? It says he provided abundantly to them, took care of all their needs. And David, one more out of the Old Testament, David, in both 1 Samuel 24 and 26, he had two opportunities, already anointed, that he would be the king of the kingdom, two opportunities to take Saul's life. And what does he say? "But my eye had pity on you. I will not stretch out my hand against my Lord." In the fear of God, in the purposes of God, in the will of God, the timing of God, he submitted himself to show the same pity that he had received. New Testament examples. Any thoughts so far? I know there's probably on your mind already the big one out of the New Testament. We're going to get there. All right. Mercy doesn't change in the New Covenant. Praise God. Okay, there's continuity there as far as mercy is concerned, because mercy is of God's essence. It's of His character, so it does not change. Praise God for that. But it's shown. We see in Matthew 6:15, mercy is shown in our willingness and actually forgiving others, being ready, as I said, to forgive. Should someone who has offended you come and confess that what they had done, "I forgive you. I forgive you. I'm ready to forgive you." If there's repentance and confession, yes. But we always have that attitude, that readiness, that willingness, because we've been forgiven. when we have confessed, right, and repented from our sin, so we are ready to forgive others who have sinned against us when that occurs as well. That's the whole premise of Matthew 18. And again, mercy is living in the awareness of the mercy shown to us in forgiving our enormous debt, so we gladly show mercy to others. That's that wonderful and really mind-blowing parable of the king who took account of his servants. And the first servant owed him such a debt, it would take, let me look at my notes here, 10 lifetimes for him to repay that debt. 10 lifetimes. And he sought the king's forgiveness. He pleaded for mercy. And what did the king do? He forgave him, right? Then what did this servant turn around and do to his fellow servant? His fellow servant owed him a debt of 1/600,000th of what he owed to the king. Probably $50 compared to 10 lifetimes. And the servant pleaded for mercy, and what happened? He had him thrown in prison. And when the king heard about his lack of mercy for what he'd been forgiven, he sent him to the torturers in the prison to pay back the debt. That is a very vivid glimpse for us of what being unmerciful, unforgiving, unrepentant will look like. It's an image of hell. Well, there will be an eternal repayment in the tortures of the flames for the debt owed to God. Amazing. Sobering, huh? All right, this is Christ's wonderful example of what it means to be merciful, to show mercy. And this is in the outworkings of the Good Samaritan. Remember, Samaritans were not the Jews' favorite buddy. They hated the Samaritans. They despised them. But we can get a great understanding of mercy and its outworkings in what this Good Samaritan, this example, did, of what an example he is of what it means to be a good neighbor and the cost that it may entail. But what are some of the key points that we observe when we read this text? The question was, I don't want to get to that yet. The question came up before he gave this parable, right? One of the lawyers, the scribe, says, well, who's my neighbor? Two greatest commandments, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Second one is love your neighbor as yourself. And he says, well, who is my neighbor? Here's the example of the neighbor. And it's important because it is this act of the Samaritan that demonstrates very clearly for us in great detail what it is to be merciful. And there's two key items here in this parable about what it is to be merciful to your neighbor. Because who is your neighbor? Just the folks in here? Everybody is our neighbor. Everybody we come in contact with, everybody we're associated with. So the first key point that I want to look at is that mercy takes on responsibility. The Samaritan sought to relieve the consequences of sin in the lives of this man who'd been left for dead on the side of the road, helping to heal and encourage those bruised, just like Christ did. He never broke a bruised reed, did he? He never snuffed out a flickering flame. He always extends mercy. And we see that in all of his miracles, all of his mercifulness manifested to those who did not deserve it, such as we. But what do you do? Well, the Samaritan, he worked within the context of the immediate need. He brought relief, and with the means he had, and he went above and beyond that. If there's further needs, he gave to the innkeeper. If there's any more needs, here's some extra money to cover it. And if there's more, I'll make dues right when I come back. But what if you see a need The opportunity to extend mercy is there and you don't have the means. What do you do? That's why we're in the body of Christ. That's the beauty of the body of Christ. I may not have the means, but I know there may be others who do. And an opportunity to show mercy, to alleviate the effects of sin or whatever may happen in another's life, and to pursue that is a blessedness. It brings the joy of Christ into the soul. And so don't feel like, well, I want to help, but I can't. Grab a brother, grab a sister, make it known, work towards that. And I know you know this, but it's not to toot your own horn. That's not what I'm referring to. But to be mindful and to take action for those who are in need. And whether it's the next door neighbor or my neighbor in the seat next to me. Right? Amen. It's very convicting for me preparing this, so I'm ready to be transformed by the renewing of my mind. Amen. The second one, mercy mortifies our selfishness. When we get an opportunity to extend and pursue mercy and helping one another, it mortifies selfishness. This man, this good Samaritan, sacrificed his plans to administer care to another. He didn't chase after the robbers. It was the immediate need, the immediate care, right where he was in his context. He didn't post or tweet about the failures of society that cause these crime-ridden areas in the street. No. He worked in the context and with the means he had and above that. But the priest and the Levite, they had their reasons for leaving the man there, didn't they? What if he was dead? Well, they would be ritually unclean, but is that a sin? They would miss out on their ordinary routine of the day. And Jesus even ignored the defilement of touching a dead body and demonstrated mercy in his care and power. So the merciless behavior of the priest and the Levite was their refusal to pay the cost of being inconvenienced and refusing to die to their own plans rather than to submit to the providence and the purpose of God in their lives. I know this was a parable, but wasn't all of this in the providence of God? As Lord willing, we are going to hear from Psalm 46 later. Does God really allow, purpose all things in our lives? So when we have this providentially given opportunity to extend the mercy of Christ, oh, don't you want to do it? I mean, right? And Brother Jeremy, just like you said, mercy, justice, and humility are all the calling of the Lord. Mercy is not to be seen as an optional extra, but it's a divine necessity in our lives. And these passages speak very clear of what God desires in his people. Mercy and justice, kindness, loyalty to God and what he has provided. Not sacrifice. Better to obey in the providence of God of what he has set forth in front of you. We're not to shut out our ear to the cry of the poor. Very clear from Scripture. That last point in Matthew 7:23, very clear, those without mercy are not Christ's possession. Humbling, isn't it? Amen. So, mercy exercised. What I mean is, what is our attitude in mercy? to show, be merciful. What should our attitude be in this? How should we exhibit or exercise mercy toward another? What should be in our attitude? And I love what Paul did for us in Romans 12. Gives us great, detailed, again, logically flowing plan, reality of what the Beatitudes are exactly talking about. You can see all of this in Romans 1 to 11. And Paul begins this in Romans 12 with a therefore. And in a very good presuppositionalist approach, the very mercies of God is where we begin to consider the mercy shown to us and the mercy we're called to extend to one another. It's revealed in his gospel. It is a transforming power, and now we are to live in this manner. And as we are transformed in our thinking by the word, as our mind is renewed, as it's made proper in its order of understanding things according to God's truth, we're continually given the grace to walk in humility with one another. And as God grants us the sound judgment and the measure of faith in him, faith in him in our new life and our new walk with the Lord as our head, we are then, as a part of this body of believers, joined together with many members. And what we discover in these many members are the various gifts and the various functions that the body is to have, because the Lord has blessed us with this to carry out his purposes. And then in verse 8, it says, he or she shows mercy is to show it with what? Cheerfulness. Why cheerfulness? Why should mercy be shown in a cheerful disposition and attitude toward another? Not grudgingly. Oh, I got to do this. I'm expected to do this. If I don't, the elders are going to be mad at me. I really don't like this person. I don't really want to help. Is that Christ in our attitude? With the mindset of the mercy reality and living in the reality that the mercy that God has shown us, he showed it to us with immense pleasure, immense cheerfulness, love, compassion, willingness, and joy. And has his mercy brought you great joy? And so cheerfulness is rendering mercy to the needy is what gives the most value to the service. I love what Calvin said here. Great quote. For as nothing gives more solace to the sick or to anyone otherwise distressed than to see men cheerful and prompt in assisting them, so to observe sadness in the countenance of those by whom assistance is given makes them feel themselves despised. So a joyful, Christ-honoring, Christ-centered expression of mercy is what we're called to. Not a happy, happy, joy, joy, but the heartfelt blessedness of the opportunity because of Christ to be merciful to one another and to meet whatever need is necessary. And if those means are not available to you, Chris, man, hey, I heard this need. Can you help with this? You know, Misty, anybody. That's the joy of living Christ-like and expressing the grace, the compassion, and the mercy that we've received in and through him. Yes, Pastor. Amen. Yeah.
Keep the law, and it just shines this picture and this condemnation on all of us that we have not kept the law.
Yeah.
It's amazing how, just to see what it looks like to love your neighbor, Jesus says, these are the things you must do, but we have failed to do those things, and we don't love our neighbor as God has loved us. And just to, even to see an inkling of a desire to love our neighbor is evidence of God's powerful grace in our lives.
Amen. 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 And tying on to that, what if we realize, what if our hearts are very convicted right now? In our maybe lack of joy and mercy, maybe even not having an awareness of the blessedness it is to be merciful. We ask, we seek, and we knock. Would you give me, Father, that disposition? Would your Spirit work in me that same disposition that was in your Son, so I can not only bring honor to him, but I can be like him in this world? And I can, that would you help me to grow in that? Oh, the Father loves those prayers. He will answer those. I promise you, he will answer those. So the mercy already, well, I'm getting close here. We've been discussing all this. This is the reality of a child of God right now. The supreme example of all is the mercy God has shown in sending us his Son. True mercy is found only in him and through him. And that's where our source of being merciful comes from. We look at the cross of Christ. Those who are merciful, they are blessed. They know the soulish happiness of receiving God's undeserved mercy. And as they sow mercy in the lives of others, they shall receive merciful treatment in the hands of others. That's where we experience the already, they shall receive mercy. It's not that we do it to earn something. We do it because of the disposition of Christ already in us. And so that mercy will be extended one to another. And as that promise, those who are merciful actually do themselves good. They know that true happiness of living the new life in Christ. Proverbs 11:17. And then we have the promise from God himself in Proverbs 18:25. With the merciful, you will show yourself merciful. A great happiness to be the instrument of God's mercy to another and to receive the blessing of mercy from God our Father. A greater awareness of the, like Paul says, it's not a mercy we've received, the mercies of God that we have received. And so the not yet reality, there is a future and final fulfillment. But it is something we will rejoice in and glorify God forever. His mercies will always be the song in our lips, the praise of our lips. Just like Paul in 2 Timothy 1, where Paul's desire for Onesiphorus to find that final mercy from the Lord on that day of his return, that day of his glory, that's when we will see that mercy consummated as he calls us to himself and transforms us in the twinkling of an eye. And then in Jude, we are waiting for that mercy, anxiously anticipating for that mercy to eternal life. So have mercy on those who doubt. Have mercy saving others. Have mercy on some with fear, Jude says to us, because of the mercy we've been shown. And his coming mercy to us will be his ultimate acknowledgement of us as his own redeemed people at his coming in his resplendent glory. The already, not yet, reality, truth of what it is to be merciful. Amen? Any last questions, comments? How am I doing? Oh, not bad. Praise God. Yes, brother.
Essence of mercy in the gospel. And and that that is ultimately sharing with the proclamation of the gospel, and the sharing of the gospel.
Amen.
Ultimately, you know, what the best way to show mercy.
Yep.
I think it's while meeting the physical needs of people is also a way to show mercy.
Yeah.
What good is it to meet somebody's hunger or thirst, physical hunger or thirst, if you don't share the gospel?
Not the gospel. Amen.
Christ. And that's something that I feel like is present in our world right now, where so many people think that, you know, if I go feed the hungry, if I go do this, build a house,
amen,
build a water well, then I'm doing God's work. And yes, we are, but if that person dies without Christ, what good was it for them to have water or food if they don't have Christ?
Yeah, because the warning there is their blood's on your hands, you know? And that's of the essence of the gospel, because it's of God's essence. He is mercy itself, right? And so, yes, there was an implication that with all of this practical, there is the spiritual right in tow, right in harmony with it. If you do one without the other, you're just being pragmatic, right? But we can be spiritual and practical too. That's the beauty of it, to meet those needs. Amen. Praise be to God for his excellent mercies. Amen. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. I need mercy. Amen. Thank you all. Any last questions, comments? Yes, brother. There you are. Yes, if there is criminal activity, then we should include and involve those authorities that God has put in place for the sake of justice. Should we have a heart, a willingness to forgive? Yeah. If there is not ever any confession of an awareness of what they've done is evil and wrong and ask for forgiveness, then that forgiveness is never being administered. But there's always a desire, a readiness to show that mercy. Is it an opportunity to possibly take the gospel to that person while they're incarcerated? Yeah. Yeah. But justice, yeah. If something criminal happened in our body, Pastor Landon and I would be the first to call the police. That's a necessity. We have to do that. We're not given that authority by the Word of God to handle those matters that way. Yes, sister.
Sorry.
That's all right.
A couple of times in talking about forgiveness, I think you referenced the wrongdoer's willingness to apologize, recognize that they did wrong. So when you're talking about forgiveness in that context, are you talking about it like in a relational sense? Or I guess where I'm going with that is harboring unforgiveness in your heart towards somebody where it causes
That can be sinful. Yeah, in the Lord's Prayer that we're going to get to in months ahead, talking about forgive us of our sins as we have forgiven others. And so those who have, if we are harboring bitterness, wanting to revile because they did or said something to us, what are we to do? We should go to them and work to resolve that. And there again is Matthew 18, right? If there has been a sin where they've offended you, they have done something sinful, go pursue forgiveness with them, or pursue repentance and an awareness of that sin in a loving way, in a humble way, of course, but for the purposes of reconciling so that both you and that other person can clearly, with a clear conscience, go before the Lord and pray. But our forgiveness of another who has sinned against us is not complete unless there's been a confession and repentance of a wrongdoing. And so if we, like Matthew 18, if we see a brother or sister sinning, go to them, seek to restore, seek to pursue an awareness of their sin, seek to pursue in a loving way a confession from them and a repentance to the Lord, and you're restored. The forgiveness transaction, if you will, can be complete in that sense. And that's just between you and that person. You know, no Twitter, no Facebook, just right there. But if there's not, if there's a refusal, if it's like, no, this isn't sin, whatever excuse comes up that tries to diminish or play down or you know, renounce, I didn't sin, that's when you bring witnesses in to testify, to be aware of what you're presenting and speaking about what happened is actually sin. And from that testimony, again, seeking reconciliation, repentance, forgiveness. Speaking to their ignorance. If they knew that he was the Son of God, was it saying Acts, they wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory. But in their sin and their ignorance, they were crucifying, yet fulfilling the purpose and will of God, right? Through hands of evil men, the Son was offered up as a sacrifice, and God allowed that. He purposed that. But in their ignorance, he prayed, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They're just unaware. And if they came to a knowledge of Christ and a saving faith, that forgiveness would be extended to them. Yeah. Yes, brother. Yeah.
And therefore, they're held responsible, of course, for those sins. But it's another reminder of, you know, when we forgive the unbeliever, we forgive them, reminding ourselves that they're dead and trespassing.
Right. Yeah, those outside of Christ, not in the church, the world, when they sin against us, we pray for them, right? We were ready to forgive them because they're in their ignorance, they're in their sin, they don't know what they're doing, just like they were at the cross crucifying him. All right, 2:30, we need a quick break. Oh, I'm sorry, Chris. Right.
We see it even in the gospel that God showed us mercy, but there was still justice, but the justice was exacted upon Christ.
Right.
So when we speak of mercy, we don't detach from justice. We leave place for God to exact justice on those who have injured or offended us. We don't take that place upon ourselves. Just like you said, Joseph said to his brothers, am I in the place of God?
Yeah.
Am I in the place of God? So we need room for
vengeance is mine, says the Lord. Yeah. That's where we can mercifully leave it in his hands when the world has offended us and threatened us and maybe taken our lives. So, amen. Let's take a quick break. Just kind of be prepared. I want you to gird up the loins of your mind for today. The Lord has unleashed a wealth of glory in this next passage. So I'm excited. So quick break and we'll come back. Amen.